Dear Baba, it was a dreadful moment when the Bremen weighed anchor and steamed away to the open sea, leaving a desolate Kimco to return to Southampton on the tender. I felt as if my solar plexus had been removed for hours afterward. I watched the Bremen out of sight, and although I could not see your beloved form, it was impossible to take my eyes away from the ship to the last second. Darling, how much love you have taken with you. All my heart is yours. It is just beating out the seconds till we meet again.
Like the beat, beat, beat of the tom-tom when the jungle shadows fall. Like the tick, tick, tock of the stately clock as it stands against the wall. Like the drip, drip, drip of the raindrops when the summer shower is through. So a voice within me keeps repeating you, 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 night and day. You are the one, only you beneath the moon and under the sun. Whether near to me or far, it's no matter, darling, where you are, I think of you. Night and day, day and night. Like the beat, beat, beat of the tom-tom when the jungle shadows fall. Like the tick, tick, tock of the stately clock as it stands against the wall. Like the drip, drip, drip of the raindrops when the summer shower is through. So a voice within me keeps repeating you, 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 night and day. You are the one.
I have not come to establish any cult, society, or organization, nor even to establish a new religion. The religion I shall give touches the knowledge of the one behind the many. The book that I shall make people read is the book of the heart, which holds the key to the mystery of life. As for ritual, I shall teach humanity to discriminate, express, and live rather than utter it. I shall bring about a happy blending of the head and heart. Societies and organizations have never succeeded in bringing truth nearer. Realization of the truth is solely the concern of the individual. Every being is a point from which a start could be made towards the limitless ocean of love, bliss, knowledge, and goodness already with him. No spiritual master brings religion to the world in the form which it eventually assumes. His very presence is a blessing and radiates spirituality. He imparts it to others by personal contact. The so-called religions are an effort to commemorate the association with a great spiritual master and to preserve his atmosphere and influence. It is like an archaeological department trying to preserve things which only resuscitate the past. The living spirit being absent, religions or organizations gradually lose their glamour. The result is a mental revolt against the established order. Something more substantial and practical is required, which expresses the life of the spirit. There exists at the moment a universal dissatisfaction and an indescribable longing for something that will end the chaos and misery that is holding the world in its grip. I will satisfy this craving and lead the world to real happiness and peace by making people look more into things than hitherto. As a rule, masters help individually according to temperament and fitness of the aspirant. But this being an avataric period, which means the end of the previous cycle and the beginning of a new one, my spiritual help to humanity will be both individual and collective. The period of junction of the old and new cycle usually connotes the advent of a master who rejuvenates religious thought, infusing new life and meaning into the old order of things. Besides imparting the highest state of spirituality to a select few, he gives a general spiritual push to the whole world. The West looks at things only from the standpoint of reason and logic, and is skeptical about things which baffle the intellect. Intellect is the lowest form of understanding and is developed by reading, hearing, reasoning, and logic. These processes create an illusion of real knowledge. The higher state of understanding is permanent illumination, through which one experiences and sees things as they are. In this state, one feels at harmony with everyone and everything, and realizes divinity in every phase of life, and is able to impart happiness to others. Here, one attends to all duties and material affairs, and yet feels mentally detached from the world. This is true renunciation. The last and highest state of understanding is the merging of the soul into the limitless ocean of infinite bliss, knowledge, and power. One who has himself attained this freedom can make thousands perfect like himself. I intend bringing about a great spiritual revival in the near future, utilizing the tremendous amount of energy possessed by America for the purpose. Such a spiritual outpouring that I visualize usually takes place at the beginning or end of a cycle, and only a perfect one who has reached the Christ state of consciousness can make such a universal appeal. My work will embrace everything. It will permeate every phase of life. Perfection would fall short of the ideal if it were to accept one thing and eschew another. The general spiritual push that I shall give to the whole world will automatically adjust problems such as politics, economics, and sex, though these are not directly connected with the original theme. New values and significance will be attached to things which appear to baffle solutions at the moment. The benefits that shall accrue to different nations and countries when I bring about the spiritual upheaval will be largely determined by the amount of energy each one possesses. The greater the energy, however misapplied, the greater the response. The master merely diverts the current into the right channel. It will be one of my greatest miracles to bring together and blend the realistic West with the idealistic East, and the West at the zenith of its intellectual and material attainment, and the East at the height of its spiritual manifestation in the shape of a perfect master, will meet without shaming or looking down upon each other. I repeat, materialism and spirituality must go hand in hand. The balance of head and heart must be maintained. The head for discrimination, the heart for feeling, whereby it is possible to realize infinite consciousness in art, science, nature, and every phase of life. I have become one with the infinite source of everything. This is the state of Christ consciousness. If people call me Messiah, Savior, or Redeemer, it does not affect me. Terms and names do not matter. What really matters is the state of Christ consciousness that I eternally enjoy, and towards which I shall lead all who come to me. When I speak, my original message will be delivered to the world and will have to be accepted. The ability to perform miracles does not necessarily connote high spirituality. Anyone who has reached the Christ consciousness can perform them. People must not come to me merely for help in their physical infirmities or for material purposes. I shall perform miracles when the time and situation demand, and not to satisfy mere idle curiosity. Spiritual healing is by far the greatest healing, and this is what I intend to give. The highest is latent in everyone, but has to be manifested.
time.
Shri Sadguru Meher Baba, who has been completely silent for 7 years. I will ask him a few questions and he will reply by means of his alphabet board. What is your mission? Others realize the truth in every phase of life and to make brotherhood a practical fact. Why have you come especially to America? Greater energy in America than elsewhere, but most of this energy is misdirected. I will divert it into creative and spiritual channels. What will happen when you break your silence? Those to whom I speak will be instantaneously convinced of the truth.
It is not practical to overemphasize the material at the cost of the spiritual. It is not practical to have spiritual ideals without putting them into practice. But to realize the ideal in daily life, to give a beautiful and adequate form to the living spirit.
Thank you. I was particularly glad to come to California because of the opportunity which it afforded to contact those who made or appeared in motion pictures. And I am delighted that this gathering could be arranged tonight. I do not need to tell you who are engaged in the production and distribution of motion pictures what a power you hold in your hands, nor do I doubt that you are fully alive to the responsibilities that the wielding of this power involves. He who stimulates the imagination of the masses can move them in any direction he chooses, and there is no more powerful an instrument for stimulating their imagination than motion pictures. People go to the theater to be entertained. If the play is strong, they come away transformed. They surrender their hearts and minds to the author, producer, director, and stars, and follow the example which they see portrayed before their eyes more than they themselves realize. The press and the radio influence thought, but both lack the power of visible example, which is the greatest stimulant to action, in which the motion picture offers better now than any other medium. We find ourselves today in the midst of a worldwide depression, which affects everyone, rich and poor alike, and from which all are groping blindly for deliverance. The film companies, the picture theaters, and the stars have also suffered from it. If they could help to end the depression, I am sure they would be glad to. How can the motion pictures help in this respect? First, it must be understood that the depression is not an accident, nor is it purely the result of overproduction and inflation. Those, although the immediate causes, are merely the instruments which were used to bring the depression about. The depression itself was caused by those entrusted with the evolution of humanity. Man has to be stripped of his material possessions in order that he may realize through actual experience that his true base is spiritual and not material. Then will he be ready to receive the truth which I have come to bring. This truth consists of the knowledge that man, instead of being a limited, separate individual, completely bound by the illusion of time, space, and customs, is eternal in his nature and infinite in his resources. This world illusion is a dream of his imagining, a play enacted in the theater of his consciousness. A comedy in which he is at once the author, producer, director, and star. but his absorption in the role which he has chosen to enact has made him forgetful of his true self, and he stumbles now as a creature through the path he has created. Man must be awakened to his true nature. He must see that all material expression depends upon and flows from a spiritual being.
I want to try to help you to raise that family of yours, if you'll let me.
Then he will be steadfast and serene under all circumstances. There will be no further need then for the depression, and it will disappear.
Meanwhile, you just go and put some more coal in that fire. You go straight out and buy a new coal scuttle. Yes, and you do that before you dot another I, Bob Cratchit.
I'm singing in the rain, just singing in the rain. What a glorious feeling, I'm happy again.
Now, how can the motion pictures help man attain this realization?
The sun's in my heart and I'm ready for love.
The character of the film need not be changed. Love, romance, and adventure are themselves fundamental. They should be portrayed as thrillingly, as entertainingly, and as inspiringly as possible. The wider the appeal, the better. What needs to be changed is the emphasis or stress. For example, courage is a great virtue, but it may, if misapplied, become a vice.
You mean it?
So it is with love, the mainspring of our lives, which may lead to the heights of realization or to the depths of despair.
Oh, but Patty,
I don't care what Patty said. I'm getting out of this dump.
No better example can be given of the two polarities of love and their effects than that of Mary Magdalene before and after meeting Jesus. Between these two extremes are many kinds of love, all of which are good, but some of which are better than others. I use the term good and better simply to designate the degrees of liberation which they lead to or confer. Even the love which expresses itself through physical desire is good to the extent that it frees one from the thraldom of personal likes and dislikes and makes one want to serve the beloved above all other things. Every human relationship is based on love in one form or another, and endures or dissolves as that love is eternal or temporal in character. Marriage, for example, is happy or unhappy, exalting or degrading, lasting or fleeting, according to the love which inspires and sustains it. Marriages based on sexual attraction alone cannot endure. They lead inevitably to divorce or worse.
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
Marriages, on the other hand, which are based on a mutual desire to serve and inspire, grow continually in richness and in beauty, and are a benediction to all who know of them.
does that get?
To lead men and women to the heights of realization, we must help them to overcome fear and greed, anger and passion. These are the result of looking upon the self as a limited, separate, physical entity, having a definite physical beginning and a definite physical end, with interests apart from the rest of life and needing preservation and protection.
Help me, Clarence, please. Please. I want to live again.
The self, in fact, is a limitless, indivisible, spiritual essence, eternal in its nature and infinite in its resources. The greatest romance possible in life is to discover this eternal reality in the midst of infinite change. Once a person has experienced this, one sees oneself in everything that lives. One recognizes all of life is his life. Everybody's interest is his own. The fear of death, the desire for self-preservation, the urge to accumulate substance, the conflict of interests, the anger of thwarted desires are gone. One is no longer bound by the habits of the past, no longer swayed by the hopes of the future. One lives in and enjoys each present moment to its fullest. There is no better medium to portray this than motion pictures. Plays which inspire those who see them to greater understanding, truer feelings, better lives, need not necessarily have anything to do with so-called religion. Creed, ritual, dogma, the conventional ideas of heaven and hell and sin are perversions of the truth and confuse and bewilder rather than clarify and inspire. Real spirituality is best portrayed in stories of pure love, of selfless service, of truth realized and applied to the most humble circumstances of our daily lives, rained out into manifold expressions through home and business, school and university, studio and laboratory, everywhere evoking the heights of joy, the purest love, the greatest power, producing everywhere a constant symphony of bliss. This is the highest practicality. To portray such circumstances on the screen will make people realize that the spiritual life is something to be lived, not talked about, and that it and it alone will produce the peace and love and harmony which we seek to establish as the constant of our lives.
When you begin giving.
like the beat, beat, beat of the tom-tom. When the jungle shadows fall, like the tick, tick, tock of the stately clock as it stands against the wall. Like the drip, drip, drip of the raindrops when the summer shower is through. So a voice within me keeps repeating you, 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 night and day. You are the one. Only you beneath the moon and under the sun. Whether near to me or far, it's no matter, darling, where you are, I think of you. Night and day, day and night.